Hi, I'm Jay Roberts.
And I'm Brandon Beligni.
And welcome to the Howard Roberts Sessions, a video series dedicated to the legacy of my father, HR.
So come and join us at the campfire while we tell some stories and listen to the music of Howard Roberts, one of the most heard guitar players of all time. We're so thrilled to be able to share his incredible journey with you all. Make sure that you subscribe down below, and that way you'll get all the videos as they come out. Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to another HR Sessions episode.
Cheerios.
So happy to have you all here. And we're so thrilled about the great feedback we're getting about the Howard Roberts Project documentary. And if you haven't checked that out, all five episodes are out online now. So go back and take a look at those, and you're going to love it. We're
absolutely
sure of it.
Absolutely, man.
And we got yet another bonus feature from that documentary.
Bingo.
Yeah. We got an episode dedicated to the black guitar. Mm. It's known as the Franken guitar in some circles. Mm-hmm. It was quite a piece of work, and it's truly a testament to Howard's brilliance.
Yeah, and his tone. Mm. You know, he had such a magnificent guitar sound and tone, and he worked very, very hard and diligent on that day in and day out. Everything from guitar strings, boiling guitar strings. I remember seeing him do that. And shaping the necks and cutting things and changing pickups. And he was just really into that. And his tone was basically established primarily with that guitar. That was where it started, and that set the benchmark for everything after that. So I think you're really going to dig it, because we have a wonderful historian telling us the ins and outs of that guitar. Mr. Wolf Marshall is going to share how that guitar was built, where it came from, and where it went. So, enjoy.
Guitar, which I'd been trying to identify for probably 15 years, was really a guitar that never existed. Howard had put this together and from a number of parts and with the help of many luthiers, and it's kind of a one-of. It started out belonging to Herb Ellis, who owned it as a Charlie Christian model, and that was the guitarist who everyone wanted to be like, prior to Howard, of course, but and Wes Montgomery and all those guys. He was the first wave of jazz guitar. He started that electric jazz thing, and all the players wanted. So Herb got this guitar. Long story short, Howard ended up with it because he liked it so much that Herb finally gave it to him or sold it to him, and he went about modifying the instrument. And as you can see, here are several modifications. To begin with, the body has been scaled down. It's much, much thinner, and it's been redesigned to have a cutaway here and a cutaway here, because it was originally a non-cutaway guitar. So it's a double cutaway with this unusual cutaway for the thumb. And later on, the pickup was changed. If you look back at the original Ann Margaret shots, you'll see that it had a Charlie Christian pickup, which means that's probably what Herb had. He left the Charlie Christian pickup in for that electric sound. Howard later changed this. And if you look close up, you'll see even greater detail that they moved the pole pieces. The pole pieces' holes are enlarged so that the pickup inside could be moved, so that the strings were being picked up in a different place than normally that pickup would be. So again, there's like a little bit of ingenuity there. Then they put an L5, big thick celluloid pickguard on, knobs from the 50s that would be found typically on like a Les Paul, and a different kind of bridge. They obviously painted the F-holes. The pink guitar has been painted black. Okay. The whole neck has been replaced and changed to this one, which has an ebony fingerboard with dot inlay. The original one was not ebony fingerboard with dot inlay. It has a different scale. The original scale was 24 3/4. This is 25 inches, the so-called D'Angelico scale. And that's another thing Howard specified. And then the headstock itself is sort of a quasi Gibson, but the shape has been changed. everything about it is changed because it's a whole new neck. In its quirky way, it has chrome and nickel tuning keys. So it's kind of a real a work of many luthiers over the years. I took this once to a great luthier in Orange County who had been making guitars for people like Ron Eshday, and his name is James Mapson. He said that this is not really a guitar as much as it's a collection of guitar parts flying in close formation. So I always found that really amusing, but it really describes what's going on here. He went on further to add that it probably shouldn't work as it does. It shouldn't feel right. So that's part of just the magic of what I think Howard had done and designed over his lifetime with this information that he had accumulated of how guitar should feel. Part of it is also, you may want to look on the back, is that this whole neck had been shaped through a process of trial and error with Howard applying a Bondo-like material to it in order to get the right shape and size. And then he would sand the Bondo down until it felt right. And apparently, according to Ronnie Benson, he had done this in the dark to help him feel it more and not be so objective watching it. So that's how it would look. That's just a surmisal, but it's as good a story as any to explain some of the ingenuity with which he built things and how he treated it. At one point, it had a second pickup, a humbucker, which you can see in some shots from recording sessions right here, and then Howard later on took it off. But what's interesting is he never cut into the body. Like a lot of people would when they'd add a humbucker, they'd cut into the body just like the first one's cut. He left it floating, and later on when he removed it, nothing had been changed because he hadn't cut into the body and didn't have a hole to fill. So that was a smart thing to do. The plug originally was here in the Charlie Christian model, and he moved it to the side like a Gibson 175 or L5. So that's different. So it really begs the issue of what is original on this guitar. And at one time I thought it was a tailpiece, and then later on I found out he had an Epiphone tailpiece on it. So who knows if this is the original one or not. Anyway, the guitar is an interesting thing. Some people call it a Frankenstein guitar, but it's really just an instrument that Howard had worked on, and it suited his purposes prior to his making the Howard Roberts models that came afterwards with Gibson and earlier with Epiphone.